Hello, C.S.Porter, 7th graders. So welcome to the Poetry Corner with Mr. Nick. I'm from the Missoula Writing Collaborative, and the Missoula Writing Collaborative is a group of writers who goes into school all over Missoula and western Montana to teach poetry to students. So those who went to Hawthorne in 4th grade probably had me in poetry 3 years ago. When I'm not teaching, you can often find me writing nonfiction stories, or true stories. So for the next 12 weeks, we're going to be writing poetry together once a week. I'll be posting videos with a prompt, and then you'll be writing in response to them, and I'll be commenting on your poems. Also, every week you'll have a chance to read your poems out loud to me and to the class. I'll do a Google Meet with your class, and you'll have this opportunity. This is an important part of writing a poem, is being able to share it, because long before poems were written down, they were actually spoken out loud. So reading our poems out loud really allows us to share our lives through poetry and listen to what's going on in other students' lives. So before I introduce a poem, I want you to think about what makes a poem a poem. Are poems long or short? Do they always rhyme? Do they have punctuation? Poems have been around for thousands of years, and really they take all different types of forms. It can be as short as a three-line haiku or as long as a thick book. They don't always have to rhyme, but sometimes rhyming can sound good to our ear. They don't have to have punctuation, but often periods and commas can be helpful. Really, there aren't too many rules for a poem unless it's a form poem. Form poems have a few rules, and later this spring, we'll write a few of those. Why do people write poems? Why do they read poems? Poems can really help us to show the world we see, hear, smell, touch, and taste. We each observe the world differently. So you get to show people what you see and what is important to you through your writing. Everyone who reads your poems gets to see what is important to you. Often we find we have more in common than we think. Well, this week in our poems, we're going to focus on line breaks. Line breaks are something that a lot of poems have. They help to break up the poem so that we can see each individual image or action that's happening. I'm going to start by reading a poem where all the line breaks have been taken out. Notice how it looks on the page. Each line goes all the way from left to right, just as you would see it in a book. Smart. Like the fox who grabs a stick and wades out into the water deep and deeper till only his muscles above it, his fleas leap up and up onto his head and out onto the stick, which he lets go off it floats as he swims back to shore, shaking himself to dry. By Cheryl. Phew, that was a long sentence. There was nothing really to slow me down or stop me. Now I want you to notice how I read the same words differently once line breaks are back in the poem. See how it looks different on the page, too. Smart. Like the fox who grabs a stick and wades out into the water, deep and deeper, till only his muscles above it. His fleas leap up and up onto his head and out onto the stick, which he lets go. Off it floats as he swims back to shore, shaking himself dry. Did you see how I paused after each line? At the end of a line break, we naturally pause. This allows us to focus on each individual image or action that's happening in the poem. Can you notice what made the fox so smart? Could you see him wading into the water, first deep, maybe up to his legs, then deeper, up to his throat, till only his muzzle is above the water? The fleas are leaping up and up. Can you see those tiny fleas leaping? They go out onto the stick, he lets it go, and they float off, the fleas on the stick. What a smart way to get rid of your fleas. What you're going to write today is a poem that starts with an adjective. Smart's an adjective. It describes the fox, which is a noun. What are other adjectives you can think of? Come up with a list in your class. If you're having a hard time thinking of an adjective, think of something you want to describe and how you describe it. For instance, a jaguar could be sneaky, mittens might be soft, a cherry could be sweet. Here's a sample list. If you're stuck, choose one of these. Once you've chosen an adjective, I want you to think of a story that pops in your head about this adjective. For instance, with fresh, you might think of a cherry, but you might also think about fresh ice, as this student did. Fresh. Just as the Zamboni gets off the ice, the water drip, drip, dripping to make a new layer of ice, shimmering and gleaming as the light shines on it. The once split, cracked, torn up ice, now new, smooth, and perfect, ready for the next game. The fans sitting impatiently, waiting for the players, fresh until the ref blows the whistle and the players run out onto the ice, only to tear it up again. By Alex. Notice how this tells the story of fresh ice and how it has always been made rough by all the hockey players before it is freshened up again. Notice also how you can be creative about how your words move across the page. Here are two more examples from students. Calm. Like the bright crescent moon that only returns when the darkness blankets the sky, waiting, watching, observing, protecting the small young people that are drifting into deep dreamless rest, unaware of the dark mean monsters that lurk when the moon is replaced by the large blinding sun. By Avery. Soft. Mittens lying in a blanket of snow. Inside furry, outside smooth, warm inside, cold outside, white lines, blue circles, the rest red. A mouse inside, sleeping like a baby. By Connor. Now it's your turn to write a poem. Pick an adjective. Think about what story you want to tell with that adjective. And then tell your story using line breaks, breaking it up to show each image and action. So spend about 15 minutes writing. And if you finish one, you can start a second or even a third one. Each poem can have a different adjective. So, and have fun with it.